So you are at the last phase of your technical interview and the discussion suddenly turns into access controls. And the interviewer now wants to gauge your understanding about what is access control when it comes to security. So the first question he asks you is, what is access control? How can you explain it to a beginner? The second question he asks is, explain the different types of access control. And lastly, he asked the $1 million question, which has been asked to many. What is RBAC? What stands for RBAC? And how RBAC is different from ABAC? So whether it is RBAC or ABAC does not matter, but it should not be a setback for you when it comes into your interview. So in this video, we will understand what are access controls and what kind of access controls we can use to implement security better, and especially focusing on RBAC and ABAC. So let's begin our Cybersecurity for Beginners series, guys. I am Anshul Tiwari. I work in IT. It's been 18 years now, so I have had experiences across IT industry working in different roles, and I try to bring knowledge which is useful to you, which will help you in your career. So if you like the content, do consider subscribing and give us a like. So moving on, we'll cover what is access control, first of all. Okay, so as you can see, access control is all about identity, all about proving who can access what. Okay, so 5 access control types we'll cover: DAC, RBAC, ABAC, MAC, rule-based, and then we'll end the video with the $1 million question. What is the difference between RBAC versus ABAC? A lot of people get this question during their security interviews. So let's begin. What is access control? What is access control? Access control, simply put, is how a subject access the object. So in this particular boy is the subject and the ball is the object, and how he access that ball is what is access control. That is, in very simple terms, you define how a subject will eventually access the object, and that is the whole basic understanding of access control in a very simple way. So without wasting any more time, let's first pick up our very first access control type, which is discretionary access control. As you can see in this image, there's a house owner who's giving the keys to to a tenant. Okay, so DAC is like a owner of house who has the keys and decides who else can have a copy. The owner can freely give, revoke, share access as they see fit. So the owner can take the keys back if he wants you to move out of the house. Okay, so similar to that, discretionary means that the owner will decide that who will have access, to the files. Like you see in here, you can give full control, modify, read, execute, whatever you want to like. Owner has the discretionary power to manage access on a subject. File sharing in Windows or file sharing in Linux is similar. Okay, you decide who will have the read, write, or execute permissions. It's the most common, very flexible, because the owner has has all the rights, but very vulnerable, because in security, there's a common saying that the user is the weakest link in the whole chain. Okay, so if the user has to decide who will do what, who will access which file, then if that particular user gets compromised, everything is compromised. And that is the downside of using discretionary access control. A lot of times malware can be installed on the system and it can inherit users' permissions, so that's a big risk, and we should not be doing it in a very secure environment. That's what is all about. If you have heard about access control list like these, this is nothing but a part of discretionary access control. It will have the details of which user will have what level of access, and the owner will decide it. Moving on, the next one is MAC, mandatory access control. So now it is a government building, and the government building, you will have secured areas. There will be a clearance required if you want to access a top secret or confidential area. And this clearance is granted by a central authority like a security officer or a security office. So mandatory access control are very strict when it comes to accessing. Okay, so there will be a security clearance which will be needed, and everything which will be there will be labeled as secret, top secret, confidential. Access to resources is determined by the system based on predefined security levels or classifications. A document labeled as top secret can only be accessed by individual with top secret clearance. So generally, military environments, highly secured environments where you are having scientific research, very, very secured information is kept. Mac is generally using, Mac is deployed there because Mac has a different file system. There's a different operating system which comes for providing Mac. It's very expensive, so not everyone can afford it. It is highly expensive and inflexible, but very good if you are working in a very secured, highly secured environment. So that is mandatory access control. Now coming to the next one, which is the main part of this video, but don't skip it. Understand this, because at the end we'll also understand how it is different from ABAC. So role-based access control is like a company, and in the company, employees have access based on their roles. If you are an admin, you will have access to the admin department and you will be able to do admin activities. If you are an HR, you will have access to the HR area, okay? And you will be able to access HR records or HR systems. So role-based access controls are very common for various reasons. So let's understand how. So in this diagram, you can see that a developer can be assigned a developer role and he or she could only do the development activities. A manager could do more and the business user could do entirely different things. So it is all depending on the roles you are defining. So individuals are not in picture, as we saw in discretionary controls. Okay, unlike that, role-based access control is more about not giving you the full authority but assigning you a role. It is very easy to manage, because for example, you have 100 developers. Instead of setting the rights and access control for all 100, you will assign them the developer role. And whatever access comes with that particular developer role will automatically get inherited by those users. So it is a balance which RBAC provides between security and usability, because a very tight security will make it too rigid to be used. A very loose security, will make it vulnerable. So it is a balance which RBAC provides, and that's why it's very, very, very common to use it in corporate and enterprise environments. Okay, where employee needs access to different resources based on their roles. Okay, and roles can change over time. So a developer could become a manager. So this role has to be discarded and the manager role has to be assigned. So this is role-based access control. There is another RBAC, which is not called as RBAC, but the name is almost the same, rule-based access control. So as you can see, this person is crossing the signal because the traffic lights are green, and that is what is rule-based. Rule-based means the access will be controlled by fixed, predefined rules. And those rules have to be adhered by everyone, be it the vehicle or be it the pedestrian. Both have to respect those rules. The best example for this would be the firewall. A firewall has definite rules defined. This particular application could listen to this particular port. This particular application could connect to this particular another application on this particular port. This is the source. This is the destination. Everything is defined, and that is rule based. It is very dynamic, so it can change very quickly based on the changing environment. And it offers high degree of security because it enforces access policies strictly based on predefined rules. So basically, the rules will define who will access what, and that is why rule-based access control is a great way. I won't say it is very flexible, because you can't just keep on putting rules over rules. So it is good when it comes to things like firewalls, but you can't set rules when it comes to people, right? You can't set it like that. So that's why RBAC is better there when it is more user-related access control. And for systems and devices, I think rule-based works better. Now, I think the last one is attribute based access control, which is also called as ABAC. Sorry, I have missed writing it here. So it is ABAC. So what is ABAC? ABAC goes beyond RBAC. It says, I will not give you access purely based on your role. I will look for your attributes. I will look, for example, for in this pub, I cannot let you enter if you are not 18 plus. That is your age attribute, right? So what kind of attributes we have? We have our personal attributes. We have our environmental attributes. And then we also have our system attributes. So all these attributes can be combined together to have a very granular level of access control, because you can have a very fine, fine-grained access control right to the level where you want to control it. And that's why ABAC is the thing which is used in cloud very heavily. So yeah, I've got it here, ABAC. So ABAC, as I said, uses attributes, users, environment, data. So as you can see, you will have subject attributes, environment attribute, resources attribute, and then there will be a policy which will be created using these attributes, which will be sent to an authorization engine, and that engine will decide whether to permit or not permit. Cloud like AWS, Azure, GCP, all these providers use ABAC because it offers a very, very good flexibility to maintain permissions. Also, you don't need policies a lot. So basically what happens in RBAC, you will need to maintain policy for every role, okay? But in ABAC, you can have a centralized policy, and based on the attributes, you can maintain the access. We'll understand that when we'll compare RBAC versus ABAC. So these policies will be easier to manage, okay? These policies can be changed quickly, can be modified quickly. So I've taken an example from AWS. I might put the link of this article from where I picked it up. So basically, this is RBAC. So imagine that there are three set of businesses accessing three different projects. Okay. And there is a heart project, there is a star project, and there is a lightning project. So basically, you will have policies for each of these, projects. So for example, if these set of users want to access Lightning as well as Star project, then they have to be assigned two different policies. Okay. One for this one and one for this one. So it becomes cumbersome because everything is, it is maintained as role based. But when it comes to ABAC, everything revolves at a centralized, policy control. So the permissions will be here regardless of whatever access you provide, on your project. So the Lightning project, now you want to access the Star project, that's fine. You will only be assigned additional attributes and the access will be done. Okay. So that is the beauty of using attribute based access control, because it is very easy to manage. It is very flexible and it is very low grained. You can maintain it at a very low level. So I have also highlighted some differences. Access based control, roles assigned to users. Here, attributes of user, resources, environment decides the control. Granularity, it is very coarse grained. Predefined roles are there. It is very fine grained. We have talked about it. Flexibility, it is less flexible. It is highly flexible. Access decisions are based on dynamic attributes. It can change on the fly. Simpler to manage when roles are well defined. Obviously, if the roles are well defined, then obviously role-based access control is better. But in dynamic environments where you never know who needs what and who needs to be revoked, which access needs to be revoked dynamically, then their attribute-based access control is better. Scalability, it is obviously easier to scale because it's easier to manage. This needs, this is complex. Scaling this needs more time. And complex, like example use case would be your corporate environment where you have predefined roles. And here cloud environment, where the access can be decided based on the time of your access, location, which device you are coming from. All those things could decide whether the access should be given to you or not. So this is attribute based access control, and I hope now you are clear with what is access control, 5 types of access controls, and what is the difference between role based access control and attribute based access control. If you want me to make more detailed video specifically focusing on RBAC and ABAC, do let me know. I'll try to prepare it and come with more explanation and in-depth explanation on these. But I hope now you have the fair understanding of what is access control, and I hope it will help you in your interviews. So until next time, keep learning, keep sharing, and yes, keep hustling. Bye for now.